So I just arrived a short while ago. I am here in Anaheim at WonderCon, waiting for the doors to open so that I can go inside and experience probably one of the larger conventions in the country. I am definitely excited about this. Not quite sure what to expect, but as you guys know, I am going to have some fun and also document the journey along the way. So I am here at WonderCon. The doors haven't even opened and I am here walking around. So far, we have already had a sighting of Neil Adams, which is really cool. It's nice to actually see him in person. And yes, he looks exactly how he looks in photos, but we are going to make the rounds and we're going to check out a couple of the booths that are here before the crowd even gets here. It doesn't get much cooler than this. In fact, they're actually still setting up. That's how early we are here. So not only did we get a chance to see Neil Adams, we just had a conversation with Neil Adams as well. Super nice guy. I had an opportunity to thank him for doing that fantastic sketch for TJ Watson. Told him that we actually presented it to him last night. His parting thoughts to me: thank you for sharing that story with me because I am a big softy. So again, awesome time. And we are only like 5 minutes in, so definitely more to come. So I am out here outside of WonderCon, not even sure if you can actually hear me because of the fountain and the music that is playing behind me. It has been an awesome day here. I picked up some awesome books that I'm looking forward to showing you guys at the end of this video. And I've also had some pretty solid experiences that I'll be sharing with you as well. So I am back from WonderCon and I have to tell you, I had a blast. If it wasn't clear from that footage that I showed you guys earlier, let me confirm for you, WonderCon was awesome. And I think for me, it was awesome for a couple of reasons. One, I was able to get access to the showroom floor before the doors open. And so I was able to make the rounds to kind of settle down to get myself acclimated to the showroom floor. I actually made 2 full laps around the entire showroom floor to kind of see where things were. And it also gave me an opportunity to shoot some footage for you guys. I think that if I were trying to look for books and talk to people and shoot footage at the same time, it would have been a little difficult. But because I was able to get that access, I was able to shoot the footage, get that pretty much all out of the way before I ever started looking for books or starting to engaging people. That actually brings me to the second thing that made this really fun for me. I had an opportunity to meet several subscribers to the channel, and I absolutely enjoyed that. This, as you guys know, is pretty much a one-way conversation, unless we're in a live chat where we can mix it up a little bit more, but even that still is somewhat limited. When I was walking the showroom floor, there were no limitations, and I was able to spend a fair amount of time engaging people that subscribe to the channel, and it made it really fun. Guys like Alex and Roger and his daughter really stand out in my mind. There were many other people that I've honestly forgotten their names, and apologies for that. But there was one guy that really stood out, and it was a guy by the name of Grant. And I was standing having a conversation with Tori. I did an interview with Tori he's a facilitator. And I was talking with him, and Grant walks up to me and he says, 1G, 1G. And I kind of look at him. He's like, yeah, you're Reggie with 1G, right? I said, yes, I am. And we start to have this conversation, and he's like, yeah, I'm 1G as well. And I'm going to say, what's your name? He's like, Grant. I was like, that makes a lot of sense. Well, technically my name is Reginald, so that is also 1G. And we just had a really fun conversation. And during this conversation, Grant shared with me that he watches a lot of my videos. He mentioned that his grandson and his son also watched the channel. And it was just a fun engagement. And Grant wasn't the only guy that I had fun with. There were many other people that I engaged with throughout the day that I was there. There was actually one guy that walked up to me while I was sorting through books, and he says to me, I recognize you from YouTube. I just want to say, keep up the good work. And that was it. We shook hands, we parted ways, and that was it. And it was really cool just to be able to engage with many of you that watch this channel. And so that, again, made it fun for me. The third thing that made it really cool was that I was able to pick up some awesome books. And as you would imagine, many of these books are Spider-Man related, and there is one that isn't, and I'll show you that one. But they are Spider-Man related because I had a goal for my attendance at this meeting. And if you think back to the video that I released on Friday, it was about how to plan for a convention. And part of planning for a convention in my mind is to have a goal, have an objective. What is your purpose? My purpose was to identify, find, and purchase amazing Spider-Man books that were on my list that were between 1 and 261. That was the goal. And I identify a lot of books. I didn't bring home all of those books for a lot of different reasons. In some cases, the prices were really good, but the quality of the book wasn't really where I wanted it to be. In some cases, I was able to find some awesome books that were ones and twos, sometimes a three, where I wanted to be more of a 5, 6, up to maybe an 8 kind of range for my books. And so I passed on a lot of the books, either because the quality wasn't where I wanted it to be or because the price wasn't where I wanted it to be. But the great thing is that there were so many vendors, right? So many vendors with great inventory that I had an ability to kind of pick and choose. In some cases, I could find one book at one dealer, go next door, find the same book, and be able to decide which one had the best price and which one had the best grade, and then pull the trigger from there. It was just fun to be able to hunt and fish where the fish are. And so as part of that, I want to show you guys some of the books that I picked up. And I'll also, over the course of this, kind of give you some insight into, you know, whether there's a story behind the book or not, because in some cases there are some awesome stories. So the first couple of books that I want to show you actually come from a shop in Pasadena, California. And I used to spend a lot of time in Pasadena, California at one point in time. This particular shop is actually near a barber shop that I used to go to back in the day. So you kind of know that it was a long time ago because I actually had hair to cut then, unlike now. But met an awesome shop owner. We had a great dialogue. And so I picked up a couple of books from him. The first one, Amazing Spider-Man 112. This is a really nice Romita cover. This one
with the yellows and reds really reminds me of Amazing Spider-Man 100. If you remember that cover, it's a black cover, but there's also Spider-Man on the cover and he is outlined in yellow. And this one is very reminiscent of that. Absolutely love this cover. I don't think that there's anything significant about this other than that. He actually graded this book an 8, and I might actually agree with that. Maybe a 7.5, maybe an 8. But I think his grade on this book was pretty clear, especially after I took it out of the plastic, kind of looked it over. I could get on board with that. Unlike the next two books that I'm going to show you, this next one is Amazing Spider-Man 113. It is a really nice cover. I have always loved this cover and finally had a chance to pick this book up. This is the first appearance of Hammerhead. This book was also graded at an 8, very fine. I disagreed with that. Despite the fact that it's a gorgeous cover, there are some pressable defects that are noticeable here. We actually had a conversation about the quality of this book. We adjusted the price, and that's why this book ended up coming home with me. Again, I think that it's not an 8. It's actually lower than that. But again, this was a dealer that was willing to have a conversation and a dialogue, make some adjustments, and it worked out in both of our favors. This next book, Amazing Spider-Man 118, very similar. This was an 8, very fine. I disagreed with that. Made some adjustments. It came home with me. I actually found several copies of this book while at the con and at different dealers' booths. But this was by far the nicest of the copies that I was able to spot. And we also worked out a really nice deal on this. So I was very pleased with that and definitely happy to have that one in the collection. Next up, Amazing Spider-Man 172. This is the first Rocket Racer, and I think this is a three-part story arc involving the Rocket Racer. I haven't read 172 or any other part of the arc just yet, but I'm actually looking forward to reading it. Newsstand edition and a very nice copy of this book. Next up, Amazing Spider-Man 174. He's back, the pulse-pounding Punisher. Outside of the fact that it's a nice copy of this book, it is a newsstand. There isn't much significance to this one, but again, a nice book to have in the collection and puts me further along the path of actually completing my run for Amazing Spider-Man. And I'm getting a little closer with this sustained focus that I've had. The next book, 192, this is a newsstand. Really nice cover on this one. This book, I don't think there's anything significant about this one, but I believe that this was a half-priced book. There were actually a couple of dealers there that actually had books 50% off, and I took as many of those books as I possibly could. To that point, here is Amazing Spider-Man 202. This was another book that was 50% off. This book is in solid shape. The only thing that's wrong with it is that there's a little bit of waviness to the top. I think the book had just been mishandled a little bit. Nothing that a press could not fix. So definitely a really nice copy of this book featuring Mr. Frank Castle. This next book is one that I've wanted for a while, but I haven't been able to find it in a good quality at a fair price until WonderCon. It is the first appearance of Madam Web, Amazing Spider-Man 210, a really nice copy of this newsstand book. Pleased to have this one. I've actually been getting a lot of questions for some reason or another about newsstand versus direct. And it's to some degree personal preference, right? If I have two books that are of equal grade and quality, I'm going to take the newsstand. But if the direct is a little bit better than the newsstand, that's a little bit tougher because I may actually go with the better graded book or the higher grade or condition book versus solely picking a book versus because it's a newsstand. But again, this is a little bit of a personal judgment call. So you'll have to decide for yourself what you want to do if you are presented with that opportunity. So next up, Amazing Spider-Man 213. Nothing really special about this one. I think it features the Wizard. Yeah, nothing too special about this one. But again, a really nice book. Featuring a really nice arachnid. Very cool there. Next up, this is an interesting book because I have never heard of this. I don't know if it's a phenomenon or a character or a creature, not quite sure, but it is known as Mud Thing. And I think that this is the first appearance. This is where Hydro Man and the Sandman team up and essentially come together as Mud Thing, Amazing Spider-Man 217. And yeah, here's mud in your eye, Spidey. That's what it says. Here is, I think, the cover appearance of Mud Thing. This is Amazing Spider-Man 218. I'm guessing that this monster in Manhattan is indeed the Mud Thing. So maybe with the new Spider-Man movie that's coming out, that we might see the Mud Thing. Maybe. Probably not. Next up is Amazing Spider-Man 220. This is the first Moon Knight book that I have purchased as an adult. Don't own Moon Knight other than some Amazing Spider-Man books featuring Moon Knight that I had back in the day that I think Mark Bagley drew. This is the first one that I've ever purchased as an adult featuring Moon Knight. I don't know much about the character. I know people love him. I don't know much about him, but maybe when I get to read 220 of Amazing Spider-Man, I'll learn a little bit about Moon Knight. And then the very last Amazing Spider-Man book that I have is, I think, a really cool one. It is Amazing Spider-Man 229. This is the start of the Nothing Can Stop the Juggernaut story arc. And this is also a newsstand. I think this is a really nice cover. I just love Spidey's spider sense going off. I dig this cover. I dig this one a lot. Definitely pleased to have this one in the collection. So that was a big stack of Amazing Spider-Man. And again, I am getting closer and closer to completing that initial run of books from 1 to 261, getting closer every time I show you a book pretty much. So we will continue this pursuit until we complete that. And then we'll go to the next segment of Amazing Spider-Man books. But switching gears, I want to show you a non-Spider-Man related book, one that I've wanted for quite some time, but I've resisted. I've resisted picking it up because I wasn't able to find the book at a fair price. And at WonderCon, I was able to find it for a fair price. And in fact, what happened was I found the book, in fact, two of them from the same dealer, had a conversation with the dealer about the books, walked away, left the books there, went back to my hotel room, took a nap. Came back after my nap, clear mind, clear heart, beelined for the dealer and was like, that book is coming home. Thank you, sir, very much. And so that book is X-Men 94. It is a 7.0 off-white to white pages. I love this book. Behind me, you may be able to see X-Men 1, which is a good book. Giant Size X-Men, fantastic book. This one is the next part of that for me. And it's the next part because it's where the team from Giant Size X-Men, which I really like, move over to the Uncanny X-Men title. And so this is where the new X-Men basically begins. It is the second appearance of Nightcrawler, Storm, Thunderbird, and Colossus. And oh, by the way, Sunfire leaves the team. Boo-hoo. Sorry to see you go. Love this book. And this book is probably going to go on the wall as soon as this video airs. So if you have thoughts about what comes off the wall so that this can go on the wall, I am all ears. I definitely want to hear your thoughts about that in the comment section. So don't be shy. Don't hurt my feelings, but don't be shy about telling me what should come down so that X-Men 94 can go on the wall. And if you don't think X-Men 94 should go up there, let me know that as well. You're not going to win because it is going to go on. But feel free to comment though. So amazing opportunity to see some crazy books at WonderCon as well. I saw some amazing books. And there were two books in particular that really stood out to me for a couple of reasons. One, because of the significance of these books. Two, the quality of these books. And three, the price tag. I had an opportunity to hold the highest graded first and second appearances of Wonder Woman in the entire world. The first appearance is valued at $1.4 million, and the second appearance is valued at $175,000. These were by far the most expensive comics I have ever been able to hold. And I actually spent probably 30, maybe 40 minutes talking with the dealers that own these books. And I did so partly because they recognized me from the show. So we started talking about that. And then they shared with me, you know, the story behind how they got these books. And I was honestly blown away. I actually shot some of the footage and I showed it to you earlier in this video. But I was saving the best for last. I was saving me sharing this story about these incredible books for the very end. But I have never held that much money in my hands before. That is one expensive comic, and it is a both of them are really, really nice books. So anyway, that is essentially my con experience. I had a blast, and honestly, I'm probably potentially going to go to more cons because of how much fun I had at this one. And I know every con won't be as much fun, but when you have a good experience, it gives you the motivation to do it again and to do it more. And that's exactly what WonderCon was. So if I spoke to you at WonderCon, if I saw you at WonderCon, I want to thank you for contributing to all of the fun that I had at this convention, because it really was enjoyable. So to each one of my comic book soldiers, I want to wish you luck in the hunt. If you are going after fillers, your favorite variant, your grails, I want to wish you well in the hunt. And if I can be of any assistance to you, don't be shy about reaching out to me at RegieCollects@gmail.com and RegieCollects on Instagram. Take care.